And this one just comes with
Thank you. To show that I'm not lying about something as well, you feel baffled experience when it comes to sports. Can you give me analysis of Super Eagles performance and the
The journey for every great Akokite begins here at the main entrance to the University of First Choice and the nation's pride, the University of Lagos. For some here at the main campus of the institution situated in Akoka, Lagos, it is a journey of 4 or 5 years. For others at the College of Medicine, located at Idiaraba, it is a journey of 7 years. As a student, your fate is sealed with the matriculation ceremonies at the Tolulope Odubemi Hall. From then on, the ball is in your court. Provisions made by the university include male and female hostel accommodations, lecture halls, relaxation spots to chill out and have fun, the sports center to keep fit and flex some muscles, and of course, the university library where you get to study in a serene environment. However, it does not end there. It is right here at the Senate building. The decision determining your eligibility in participating at the convocation ceremonies at the end of your journey is taken. The convocation ceremonies are customarily an annual series of activities with pomp and fanfare, where having met all the requirements as stipulated by the institution, thousands of students like yourself are discharged and acquitted as bona fide alumni of the prestigious University of Lagos. With the first of its kind in 1969, this custom thrived for 50 years up till the 50th convocation ceremonies in 2019. In 2020, the 51st convocation ceremonies were disrupted at the planning stage by the outbreak of the coronavirus pandemic, with the introduction of global lockdown as part of combative measures. With the world recovering from that shock, over 15,000 students will be awarded degrees, diplomas, certificates and prizes at the JF Ade Ajayi Auditorium with necessary COVID-19 protocols to be observed. Welcome to the 51st Convocation Ceremonies of the University of Lagos. The convocation ceremonies of the University of Lagos are a time when people from all walks of life, students, parents, well-wishers, eminent personalities in the society all gather to felicitate with the graduating students, to celebrate the culture of excellence the University of First Choice and the nation's pride boasts. It goes without saying that human and vehicular traffic would no doubt hit a peak at such a time as this, even with the restrictions imposed by the COVID-19 pandemic. However, the experience this year would turn out to be different, as the university was keen on making the 51st convocation ceremonies a seamless one.
The transport committee has packaged a seamless system to make sure that the usual crowd we experienced during convocation is less this year. We have talked to Lamata and they have agreed to give us 40 buses, and we have some locations around Lagos from Yanakpaja, Ikorodu, Ikeja. We have SEMES. We expect our graduating students to pick buses with their parents to at least access University of Lagos. Why we have done this is to say that the usual bringing of coolers and cars to campus is drastically reduced. No partying within campus. There will be 6 buses. Now, four of the buses will be picking people from the first gate. That's the main gate. Then you have two that will be picking people from the second gate. There will be diversion of traffic from Michael to Folago to make sure that the volume to campus gate is reduced. So what will happen is that visitors will have to at least assess campus from there, and they can now pick the bus at the gates.
As a custom, the convocation ceremonies of the University of Lagos would begin with a press conference where activities for the ceremonies as scheduled will be disclosed to the public through the gentlemen of the press. The 51st of such ceremonies was not to be an exception. As the university management team, led by the Vice Chancellor, Professor Oluwatoyin Ogundipe, converged on the Senate chamber to brief the members of the Fourth Estate of the Realm, it was imperative to reflect on the past year and the aftermath of the cancellation of the ceremonies in 2020.
The event that followed the cancellation, we are even more terrifying. The university, we are stifled of funds, our budget was not approved, and it affected so many things that we, at the end of the day, got to lowest ebb in the history of this university.
According to Paulo Coelho, everything will be okay in the end. If it isn't okay, it isn't the end. And you know, sometimes, the harder you fall, the stronger you rise.
I'm glad to inform you that the university has recorded huge success since the last 1 year, particularly in the area of research. We look at what we are doing now, it's all about research, research, and research, because we need to solve the problem of this country. And through that, at the international level, we are recognized.
More specifically, Professor Ogundipe boasts of the achievements of the university recorded through the feats of her students as well as staff, academic and non-academic.
Our members of staff, both teaching and non-teaching, have not been let out of the shower of laurels and recognitions too. And two of our non-teaching staff, within the past 6 months, they also won research grants.
In what would seem like a really joyous economic intervention for the University of Lagos, considering the dark moments of 2020, this year, the institution chose to appoint a clergyman as chairman and a foremost economist as guest lecturer for the pre-convocation lecture. Saddled with the responsibility of delivering a lecture titled National Development and Knowledge Economy in the Digital Age, Leapfrogging SMEs into the 21st Century, was none other than the governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, Mr. Godwin Emefiele.
While my intent today is to awaken and instigate the job and wealth creation spirit among today's graduates, I know that many of you here expect me as the governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria to talk about small and medium enterprises, national development, and the digital economy.
In a well-articulated presentation, Mr. Emefiele identified SMEs as the backbone of national and economic development.
A vibrant and growing small and medium enterprise sector is critical for achieving our goals for enabling greater growth of the Nigerian economy and in creating jobs for our teeming youths.
Among several other charges stemming from his lecture, worthy of focus is his call for attention to food security and entrepreneurship skills by the graduating students.
And I would like to encourage all of us, and I will keep saying this, that Nigeria deserves to be a country of over 100 million or 200 million people where we must achieve food security. And I want to use this opportunity to stimulate the university communities to begin to embrace, to get the students to embrace not just agriculture but entrepreneurial skills using digital technology for the good of themselves and the country.
Reacting to the lecture, as chairman, the serving overseer, Citadel Global Community Church, and former vice presidential candidate, Pastor Dr. Tunde Bakare, in his usual manner, had words of wisdom, as we may call it, for the global audience.
This will be my closing remarks. The test of our progress is not whether we as a nation add more to the abundance of those who have much. The test of our progress will be whether we provide enough for those who have little. We cannot always build the future for our youth, but we can build our youth for the future. Thank you very much.
On this note, the tone was set for the much-anticipated three-day convocation ceremonies of the University of Lagos, the 51st of its kind. It is a cool morning on Tuesday, 6th of July, 2021, day one of the 51st convocation ceremony of the University of Lagos. All vehicular and human traffic is headed to the JF Ade Ajayi Auditorium, venue of a phenomenal event originally scheduled to hold in March 2020, but postponed due to issues better explained by none other than the Vice Chancellor, Professor Oluwatoyin Ogundipe.
If you all recall that March 2nd, 2020, on this same spot, I stood and we gathered together in this chamber to commence activities for the 51st convocation ceremonies of the University of Lagos that was scheduled for March 9 to March 12, 2020. But as it turned out, the ceremonies were cancelled as a result of personal interest of some individuals.
As graduates gathered, the relief and ecstasy was there for all to see. Relief from the disappointment due to the postponement of the convocation, and ecstasy that they could finally gather to officially celebrate an end to the academic sojourn in the University of First Choice and the nation's pride. On this day, graduating students from the faculties of Arts, Science, Education, Environmental Science and Social Science received awards of degrees in their various disciplines.
And all those whose names appear on pages 125 to 129 of the Convocation Order of Proceedings to stand up. Doff their caps and remain standing until they are admitted to their degrees by the Chancellor.
By the authority of Senate, I admit you all and severally to the degree of Bachelor of Science in various disciplines in the Faculty of Social Sciences. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Characteristic of any convocation ceremony is recognition and due reward for students with stellar performances in the academics. In this case, the first class students, and as always, the University of Lagos didn't disappoint.
Department of Mass Communication, Badeji Aisha Eniola. Ebong Patience Raymond.
There is good and there is best. She stands heads and shoulders above her contemporaries. Why, you may ask? Well, she is graduating with a CGPA of 4.90 from the Department of Economics, the Faculty of Social Sciences, as the best in humanities. Meet Popola Victoria Okpeyemi.
I wouldn't say it was easy, you know, but it wasn't unbearable. You know, there were a lot of people, you know, that I met that were impactful, you know, and contributed to my success, you know, actually. So it's been interesting. You know, there's definitely a lot of things that I wish I could have done more, you know, like sports, for example, meeting more people because I'm naturally a shy person, you know, and just being more involved in you know, in activities and, you know, just becoming better, you know, a better version of myself. I mean, I'm definitely...
Who is Victoria Popola?
Indeed, excellence gives birth to recognition. Excellence, You know, it's got something special around it. Quality. Yes, quality. And according to John Ruskin, quality is never an accident. It is always the result of intelligent effort. As students of various faculties, the Distance Learning Institute and School of Postgraduate Studies were awarded degrees, diplomas, certificates and prizes, it was no doubt a celebration of quality. From undergraduates to postgraduates, joy and fulfillment was evidently radiating because, as you would agree, it no easy. For Ayolemi Ayobami Adesoji, who emerged as the best graduating student from the Faculty of Pharmacy with a CGPA of 4.86, the recipe for excellence is quite a simple one.
My advice to them is to put God first, and they should try to focus, and they should take the first 2 years of their pharmacy class, that's their 200 and their 300 level, very serious. I took those classes serious and I emerged as the best graduating student. The subsequent classes was like equal amongst everybody. So when you eat it at the beginning, when you eat it running at the beginning, at the end it pays off. So that's my advice to them.
But excellence, no doubt, demands dedication and resilience.
It wasn't easy, I can tell you. I mean, we all know that making a first class is not easy. I mean, as a married woman with three children, with a very demanding job.
Postgraduate degrees. We'll be having all of these, you know, happening. Of course, after mention, it is also made to understand that this year's event will have a host of activities that will be around in this year's commencement of the convocation ceremony. And it's a great pleasure to actually be the anchor for this year's event while we're working with you this year's live session or transmission. My name is Bayo Salau, and of course I'm being joined by...
It's your sincerely Novena Peters. And I must say, Bayo, you know, this is actually the first of its kind to actually have a
Unilag
convocation.
I've been the man in the saddle for the past 4 years. It almost looks like it's going to be the last for the year. And as a Vice-Chancellor of the University of Lagos, interestingly, the University of Lagos Vice-Chancellor is actually having a, you know, full-packed and action-packed event lineup for your view pleasure. For every one of you who wants to be part of the convocation ceremonies, without doubt, we have opportunities for you to interact and get feedback from you as well as to whatever is getting you talking around the convocation ceremonies. You can as well visit all our social media platforms. Novena?
Yeah, and to do that, you just have to go on to Unilag on TV, and now that is across all social media platforms. So you're going to do your hashtag Unilag Convocation Studios, and of course, Unilag 2020 Convocation. Remember, hashtag.
Of course, we also understand very much that, yes, it's University of Lagos Television, Unilag on TV, like she once mentioned. But you also have to put at the back of your mind that we are just an arm of the entity, University of Lagos, as it were. So the University of Lagos Convocation Ceremony, hashtag Unilag 2020 Convocation Ceremony, if you have to make it much more wider, you know, for some of our participating audience. And do not forget, you can also view us live on across social media platforms via our caplets, via your tablets, Android phones, anywhere across the world. We shall be here to give all of the details. But do not also don't forget that today is going to be a big day. And being a big day in such a way that we are welcoming, I mean, the number four citizen of this great country, Nigeria, Right Honorable Femi Bojabiamila, an alumnus and a great one at that of this great citadel of learning. And we've always mentioned to you that the University of Lagos, without doubt, has been weighed, you know, with a lot of factors. We consider this university first choice and that of the nation's pride. And without doubt, our alumnus, our alumni, what they've been able to do has been so massive. And that's pretty much why we've been able to bring, in the last couple of years, alumnus to come and deliver our convocation ceremony lecture. And today, like I said, Honorable Femi Bojabiamila will be hitting, you know, this campus to come and tell us exactly what to expect on today's show.
So before we go into all that details, let's take a sneak peek on the preview of last year's convocation and see what we've got. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
took sacrifices, it took going the extra mile.
For some, taking it a step further was non-negotiable.
Considering the fact that I had a chance of going through a first degree and actually played a little, so I finished with a 2-2. So I felt like, okay, in order for me to just facilitate my...
We have a picture stand, please get ready. We have our distinguished guest present already. We have our chairman of the education also here with us. And I'm talking about some of the teachers here. C.O.N., commander of the Order of Niger, justice of the Supreme Court, Federal Republic of Nigeria. Today's 52nd convocation lecture.
Yes. What is the title?
The title is Building Back Better, Creating a New Framework for Tertiary Education in Nigeria.
All right, thank you very much. So this is at the innovation level. So
we also have the Pro-Chancellor
and the Chairman of the
Government of the University of Lagos, Senator Green, Dr. Olamiwaju Tejosho. Absolutely.
Fantastic. And they are going around the exhibition stand. They will be told the exhibition number, like the
right is increasing.
Exactly, we appreciate the schedule. I would love all. Thank you for an honor and invitation to the University of Lagos.
I want to see that you know you can manage.
Exactly. With the management team of the University of Lagos. That is the DBC now. The DBC Developmental Services of the University of Lagos. Professor Shoko, DBC Management.
This
one. The professor. Okay, I know that, right?
That's Dr. Olale Kalawal, FCA, and I can see the...
And the Liberian, exactly, books of... And of course, big shout out to Professor DBC, the Director of Entrepreneurship Center, University of Lagos, for all you've been doing, and the entire team that has contributed to the success of the exhibition today happening close to the main auditorium. Like we did say earlier, immediately after the exhibition, commissioning of projects, right?
Yes.
And after that, the lecture will begin.
The public council, and you don't have council members. Council members are also here today because this is an auspicious occasion. All council members are here. Definitely, we'll be looking out their names. But today's lecture is very important.
Yes, and also we have some political figures here in the University of Lagos. We will recognize them as we move on, and I'm sure the master ceremony during the lecture will recognize some of the political wins that we have realized in the University of Lagos. But most importantly, the speaker is here, the guest lecturer is here, and of course, the show will begin. The chairman of today's lecture is also here. At any moment from now, we'll be done with the exhibition and we'll move to commission of projects that the lecture will actually begin.
The lecture will continue as we are all been looking for. The Convocation lecture is here. Tomorrow is going to be one. We are going to give you a quick feedback of what we want to do. Now we are going to measure each education and training. So people for this is the maximum they are more interested. And in the afternoon,
Information return of hazard that the best graduating student for the year have finished with 4.95. Awesome. That is from the Faculty of Engineering, right? On your faculty,
congratulations.
We'll be right back.
Thank you. at the Unilag Convocation 2022. You know how we do it. I'm with the Sugar Zaddy of Unilag TV. He's right here.
They're having the best one yet. That's amazing.
You guys are there. Chinese TV.
Good afternoon, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to say that the guest lecturer is already with us, but he's going round the exhibitions. And once he's through with the exhibition viewing, we will start the lecture in earnest. But let me tell us that in the house this afternoon, we have Her Excellency, the Deputy Governor of Ogun State, Engineer Noimot Salako Oyedele. Please give her a round of applause. Excellency, you're welcome, ma'am. It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you very much. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, our Emeritus Professor Abbas is in the house. Please give him a round of applause. It's a pleasure to have you here, sir. I'm glad to say that already seated with us, Distinguished Professor Babaji Diallo, it's a pleasure to have you in our midst, sir. Distinguished Professor Una is also in the house. Please give him a round of applause. Welcome, sir. Distinguished Professor Iguilu, good afternoon, ma. It's a pleasure to have you with us. Former Deputy Vice Chancellor Development Services, Professor Ogushola, it's a pleasure to have you in our midst. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, if all goes well, it is simply because there are some people behind the curtain that are giving the members of our management the support and the succor they need. I have the pleasure to say that in the hall this afternoon, is the wife of our Vice Chancellor, Mrs. Sheu Ogudipe. Please give her a round of applause. Please, a round of applause. Our university is situated in the Yaba LCDA. And so it is our pleasure this afternoon, to have with us the Executive Chairman, Yaba LCDA, Dr. Honorable Kayode Adejare Omiyale. Please, a round of applause for him. He's also here with his Vice Chairman, Honorable Bola Aileru. You're welcome, sir. The Council Manager, Yaba LCDA, Otumba Lagiwa, is also here seated. Please, a round of applause for him. The Council Treasurer, Yaba LCDA, Ademola Jimo, we welcome you. A round of applause for them. We thank you for what you are doing for our university. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we'll say yes indeed, this is the beginning of our convocation ceremonies. And so this morning, I'm glad to say that all our professors are here in this hall. Please kindly help me give them a round of applause. All the professors of University of Lagos, Senate members who are awarding the certificate are also here seated. Please give them a round of applause. They're the members of the Senate of the University of Lagos. We have 12 faculties in our university, and I dare to say that the deans of all our faculties are also here seated. Please, a round of applause for them. And a bigger round of applause to all the heads of departments. Please give them a round of applause. Directors are also here seated. Please give them a round of applause. Thank you very much. The former registrar, Dr. Itmaye, you're welcome, man. And the former boss of our university, Dr. Depule, you're welcome. Please give them a round of applause.
Qualifications and the likes, I decided to go for a master's degree. And I mean, my father is a lecturer, is into academics. What will I be doing if I don't take up that challenge to go for a master's degree? So,
for others, short, mid, and even long-term plans are already being rolled out.
My short-term plan is to
build more skills to practice here in Nigeria and develop my skills so that I can use it as a platform to move to other greener pastures, in quotes, like they say, which is outside the country. So that's a jackpot levels.
Ever heard of the phrase, primus inter pares? It is a Latin phrase translating to first among equals in English. And oh, what a fitting description for Alimi Ibrahim.
Federal House of Representatives at the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Our chairman is also here with us. Justice of the Supreme Court of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Honorable Justice Amina Adamu Aoge, CON, and all the management team.
Adedeji, a first-class graduate of the Department of Mechanical Engineering. With a CGPA of 4.98, Alimi will go down in history books as the overall best graduating student at the 51st Convocation Ceremonies of the University of Lagos 2018-2019 academic session.
Dean's prize of 50,000 for the best all-round performance at the degree level. Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji. Mechanical Engineering, Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji. Foundation prize of 50,000 to the best graduating student in engineering faculty, Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji. Otumba Gbenga Daniel prize of 50,000 to the overall best student in mechanical engineering, Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji. Memorial Prize of 25,000 to Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji. ECPM Engineers Award of 300,000 to the best overall graduating student in engineering, Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji. 175,000 to the best graduating student in mechanical engineering, Alimi Ibrahim Adedeji.
It is indeed a feat worth relishing for the
Furthering my education. I intend to further my education. Minimum will be a master's, and I'm also looking at opportunity of a PhD.
Well, excellence has no bounds. And if you don't agree to that, wait for day 3, grand finale of the 51st Convocation Ceremonies of the University of Lagos.
Convocation studio ceremony. Don't forget, we told you earlier during our introduction salvo that it is audience participatory. You can almost reach out to us via our social media platforms across every platform that you know, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and of course the in thing now everybody seems to be on, that's TikTok, and go on there. We are live to bring everything that is happening here at the University of Lagos. It's the 52nd convocation ceremony that is, and of course I'm being joined at this moment by a man who actually held his own since he assumed position as the director of the Entrepreneurship Skill and Development Center of Uluwatu. It's a pleasure to have Professor Adebisi joining. Good morning, Professor.
Thank you very much for having me.
Fantastic. I mean, there's been so much in the hair, you know, attitudes, congratulations and all of that. But beyond that, there's been something going on that are quite intricate to the many successes recorded under Professor Okudigbe. And one of such things is the entrepreneurship drive. You want to tell us more about it?
All right, thank you very much. I say thank you for having me once again, and before I say anything, I actually want to thank some of the guys that came in with me into this studio, the great Nigerian guys, the young CEOs in Nigeria. I have Seki Makonde, who is with me in the studio, that is MD of his council, who has just led seed-funding engineering to the MD of North second largest Nigerian, you know. I'll say, guys, thank you for joining me in this studio. Entrepreneurship University of Lagos has been taken to the next level. President Lotte, who came on board, he knows what, you know, the objective to say, look here, all we need to do is that this university must be known for entrepreneurship. And I saw my job cut out for him. So, yes, it's not been easy, you know, he's a driver, he has driven me very hard, but then, you know, I'm up to the task by the special grace of God. And today, you could see that all we've done in the University of Lagos has converted all courses in this university into entrepreneurship. If you're doing chemistry, I call it chemipreneur. If you're doing Yoruba, I call it Yorubapreneur. If you're doing accounting, that's an entrepreneur. If you're doing engineering, it's engineer. If you're doing medicine, it's medicinepreneur. You see, what I've done at my center is to let every student see the potential, the commercial potential, the commerce orientation in every discipline that they are studying in this university. And amazingly, our students have been very, very awesome. As I speak, I announce to you that in the next 8 months, brand new cars will be produced by students of the University of Lagos in this university. That is the next thing we're taking, you know, these kids. And our students will go there for some of these cars. As I'm speaking to you, in the next 8 months, we will be in Nigeria, which is going to be led by the MD of Espanso. You see, it's not just the future, it is now. So the only thing I want to tell my students is, are you there? And all you need to do now is to find your route. The entrepreneurship basket development center, because the kind of thing we're doing is amazing. I just had a conversation this morning with Alex from the United States of America, who is the one that won the Ignite fashion and show. And she was saying, okay, I want to be collecting the collections of as many good products that I went with, that Nigerian products. And I will explain them and I'll give them, you know,
so, I'm afraid, this entrepreneurship, right? What we're going to do is that we do the version with that because we are about to just do the big screen while we take all the possessions and the commencement of today's lecture.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon once again, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the 52nd Convocation Lecture. It's the beginning of our convocation ceremonies, and we will take the national anthem, followed by the University of Lagos anthem.
Blessed be the man, we thank you for this day. It's a special grace to plan an event, and it's extra grace that we can look back and say with joy and assurance, Ebenezer, thus far, God has led us. We gather again, marking the beginning of the week set aside to celebrate success, to celebrate with families. We gather today with the convocation lecture. Father, in all we will do today, take preeminence, guide us, lead us. Let the lectures of today be one of those discourse and presentation that will move this nation forward. Thank you because you have answered us. At the end of today, may we look back and say, blessed be thy name. In Jesus' name.
Convocation lecture. It's the beginning of our 52nd convocation ceremonies. And our guest lecturer has been with us. To chair this august occasion in January, I have the pleasure to introduce to us Honorable Justice Amina Adamu Auye, COA, Commander of the Order of Niger, Justice of the Supreme Court of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Please give her a round of applause. Thank you very much. Dr. Aminu Ahmed, please give me a round of applause.
To address any national or international issue of concern. At the last three convocation lectures, the university had the opportunity of inviting the former governor of Lagos State, Mr. Akinwumi Akande, whose lecture was entitled Inclusion, Path to a New Nation. The vice president, who is also an alumnus of this university, who is the vice president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Oshibaju, S-A-N-G-C-O-N, whose lecture was titled Nigeria Rising. They continue in the tradition by inviting an alumnus of the 1983 sect from the Faculty of Law, an eminent personality. Guest lecturer come with great pedigree and vast experience, but also with passion for the University of Lagos. I acknowledge that he has demonstrated his passion in many ways. For instance, Right Honorable Fenugreek Hostel to students in the university to demonstrate his commitment for completion of the project. He had visited the site twice to see progress by himself. The university is proud of Right Honorable Fenugreek Hostel for his commitment to improve also going to do the turning of the sword at the loot for a new building that is coming up at the Lagos University Teaching Hospital. The title action for the university system and why he believes that HEIs have major responsibility in nation building. To chair this convocation of this administration using the 6-point agenda of University of Lagos. The U in Unilag stands for uncompromising academic standard and excellent research output. To the glory of God, within the past 4 years, this university has attracted research grants of over 17 billion naira. And this attracted recognition from tech funds saying that the University of Lagos is the university with the best university in Southwest that utilizes research grants. The N in Unilag stands for network globally, strategizing locally, and consolidating nationally. Presently, we are networking with so many universities within Nigeria, in Africa, in Europe, in the US, and everywhere in this country. And with this, our colleagues, over 260, they have been able to use that network to attract research grants to the University of Lagos. Around 40,000 euro. Also based on our networking, we have the European universities coming together, and University of Lagos is the only university recognized in Africa to collaborate with other universities in Spain, in France, in Italy, and other European countries. The I in Unilag standing for improving university finances by innovative fundraising activities, infrastructural development, and entrepreneurship orientation. And in the last while, we are able to bring in the friends of the university. Presently in the College of Medicine, almost ₦1 billion is used for the building of the animal science building in the College of Medicine. This donated also by Chief Keshintin Adebutu. We have other donors that have been able to assist the university in various ways. Then the leadership that is transformational, transparent, and transnational. You see in the university, you come into the university, you can see decision. Accountability in academics, administration, finance, and all university policies. At this point, I want to acknowledge the contribution of our Pro-Chancellor, distinguished Senator Prince Dr. Larry Tejosho, for the way he has been managing the council and running the council effectively, putting the interests of the university first, and all the members of the council believing in this university as truly the university of first choice and the nation's pride. That Unilag is a brand in this country, a university that is recognized in this country and outside this country, a university that is referred to as the powerhouse of research in Nigeria and recognized in Africa. What have we also done? We have networked with the University of Stellenbosch, and we have even non-teaching staff, two of our non-teaching staffs, we are able to attract research grants to the University of Lagos. And the student at the Technical Engineering Department won the fully funded prestigious Do Chemical, Do Innovators Invention Program a 9-month fully funded internship program in Switzerland. Also, 5 of our students won the 3-month African Leadership Internship Program with the Bank of America in 2021. Our students in the area of entrepreneurship, they have been doing very well. What the university intends to do is to register companies for the students and, with the support of the Bank of Industry, get the startup grant of maximum of 2 million naira for them to start their business, and also bring in mentors. We are able to blend with their academic program. So let me just stop like that concerning our students, because there are a lot of things, a lot of testimony to give concerning our students. Then we go to the issue of COVID-19 and e-learning. We are all witnesses to the negative impact of COVID-19 on the world, and indeed on higher education. However, upon resumption, as directed by the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria in 2021, and realizing that the pandemic was still with us, the university therefore went fully online to play our part in the natural effect to stem the tide of COVID-19. We want to thank the University of Lagos Senate for taking decision on that. We developed an e-learning platform for our students and supported them. There is no university that has been able to do that in Nigeria, to the best of my knowledge. I don't know about Africa, but I know about Nigeria. The students were given free data during the examinations, and this cost the university over 18 million naira. We also conducted pass mark concerning that. Also, our PG exam, I'd like to appreciate the great support from philanthropists that I have mentioned earlier, including Dr. Jim Ovia. At the last convocation, I mentioned that we need 3,500 tablets for our indigenous students. 3,500. And Dr. Jim Ovia paid for the 3,500 tablets, which we give to the students, and also we have some at the university library. What about the staff and student welfare? In terms of staff welfare, this administration has also done everything necessary to resolve all bottlenecks affecting staff promotion and career advancement. Again, we want to appreciate the support, the understanding, the robust management skill of the Pro-Chancellor, this Prince. We are processed for promotion once they met the required criteria for promotion. Also, the non-teaching staff who have been stagnated for years were allowed to
be the last convocation ceremony that I...
Ladies and gentlemen, I think we can do better. Please, let's raise it up for us.
Thank you very much.
I recognize on the podium the presence of the Director of Academic Planning, Dr. Mokulola Olusaki. Please give her a round of applause. I also recognize the Director of Academic Affairs, Mrs. Makide. A round of applause, please. We will move on. At this point, I want to call to the podium for his remarks the Pro-Chancellor of our university, Senator Prince Dr. Larry Tejurishu.
Engage on issues affecting the nation, and I'm always enthused by his in-depth knowledge, composure,
and the ability to marshal his thoughts. Since he became admiration under his watchful eyes, became more focused to delivering on legislative functions. I have on many occasions and in different fora joked that Mr. Speaker's vast knowledge and ability to understand complex but topical. These are our institution producing top class delegates who can effectively compete locally and globally. Mr. Speaker, sir, please consider this as a warm homecoming, and we urge you to visit your faculty today, if time permits, and maybe the Lagoon Front. Contributions to advancing the University of Lagos, particularly in the area of infrastructural development, as ably exemplified by the International Students Hostel, facilitated by you to the university. We are grateful for your continuous kind support to your alma mater. As you will see, sir, the university still needs a lot of support from your good self and other public spirited individuals. We will therefore be using this opportunity to plead that you look at
our Pro-Chancellor, Senator Dr. Larry Teju,
and other members of the Governing Council and management, professors, students, ladies and gentlemen, I stand by all existing protocol, but at least, you know, we have to say something. I am highly honored to be here, and first thing I want to say is that I'm first and foremost a law teacher. Anything else I became.
For the citation of the guest lecturer, Professor Remus.
The chairperson of today's convocation lecture, right, the Honorable Justice Amina Adamo Ajayi. I like to stand on the well-established protocol by the Vice Chancellor. Permit me also to respectfully invite the Honorable Speaker of the House of Assembly, Honorable Femi Bajabiamila, to please come to the podium here for his citation. Olufemi Hakim Bajabiamila was born on the 25th of June 1962. He started his education in Lagos at the Mainland Preparatory School, from where he proceeded to Igbobi College, Yaba, Lagos in 1973. There he had a secondary education. Upon completion of his secondary education in Nigeria, he enrolled United States of America, and earned himself a Juris Doctorate JD degree. He went on to write and pass the Georgia bar exams, after which he set up another thriving law office where he practiced until his return to Nigeria. On his return to Nigeria, Gbajemi Egbila delved into partisan politics and offered himself up for service on the platform of the then Alliance for Democracy, AD. After rigorous and highly competitive campaign, Gbajemi Egbila was elected a member of the House of Representatives. When he was chairman of the 2007 movement in the House, a group largely credited for ending the top-down agenda of the then president of Obasanjo. His exceptional record saw him overwhelmingly re-elected in 2007. In the same year, his colleagues elected him the leader of his party, the Action Congress, in the House of Representatives, and then minority leader. By the end of his second tenure, Gbajemi Egbila had sponsored the highest number of bills in the National Assembly ahead of all other legislatures in the House. In 2011, Gbajemi Egbila, for the third time, contested on the platform of his party, this time the Action Congress of Nigeria, ACN, and won. He was once again re-elected the leader of the ACN and leader of the opposition in the House of Representatives. During this period, Femi Gbajemi Egbila revived the role of the opposition in the House and continued to maintain a tough stance against the then ruling party, PDP. Femi Gbajemi Egbila was the first and only legislator to bring a motion on the floor of the House for the invocation of the doctrine of necessity during the illness and absence of President Umar Musa Yar'Adua, which led to the swearing in of Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan as acting president. He has, throughout his time in office, championed the call for fiscal federalism, accountability in public spending. He filed several lawsuits against the then federal government, whom he accused of operating an illegal excess crude oil account and spending tax. Described as an act of God. Due to his wide acceptance within the party and its members, he was overwhelmingly elected majority leader, House leader, of the 8th House of Representatives on July 28, 2015. Upon completion of his fourth term in office, Bajamia Miller opened himself up for re-election in the 2019 election, where he was re-elected for the fifth time as the lawmaker representing the 1st constituency in the House of Representatives. On June 11, 2019, he contested for the office of the Speaker of Nigeria's House of Representatives, and he has greatly improved on his innate leadership skills by attending various leadership courses at Stanford University, also UK Oxford University, Cambridge University, and world-respected St. Femi Bajamia Miller is a role model, a true and worthy leader. Representative Honorable Olufemi Hakim Bajamia Miller is happily married with children. The chairman, I present to you our speaker for today, the Right Honorable Femi Bajamia Miller, Speaker of the Federal House of Representatives of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. A round of applause.
Banters, we cracked jokes. She was very nice to me, I was very nice to her. I didn't realize that she had other plans for me. But she's a woman I greatly admire and respect. She didn't even consider the fact that, which I don't know how many of you know that, a son-in-law was the one who nominated me in that very powerful speech on the floor as the Speaker of the House, Abdul Mumuni Jibril. That's his mother-in-law.
The Pro Chancellor, distinguished Senator Prince Larry, can you show my very good friend to the sojourn to this university?
Lagoon Front. Our Excellency, I understand the Deputy Governor of Ogun State is here.
Engineer Salako Ovide, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Twain Ogunibe,
the Chairman, Committee on Defense, Honorable Jimmy Benson, and my colleagues are out here. Chairman, of course, Committee on Education, Honorable Aminu Suleiman, the University Management and Council, the Student Union member present here today, member, or all members of this great institution, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, let me first of all excuse myself and that you indulge me that I'm here without the ceremonial cap or hat, as they call it. When we went out there and they put this on me and then they put the hat, we found out that it looked ridiculously small on my big head. And the Vice Chancellor tried very hard to, he was actually afraid everybody else there was like, no, this is small. And he was like, no, it's okay, it's okay. So I decided, it was better not to conform than attempt to conform and look stupid. To take away from that, for me, that it is never good to dress in borrowed robes. I am honored to join you here today on the 52nd convocation of the University of Lagos. This is homecoming for me, as it was here in this institution that I obtained my law degree 39 years ago in 1983. And driving through the gates
this morning, I looked to my right, the old El Canary, to my left, New Hall, of course, morning.
And a lot of nostalgic feelings and a once walked through the grounds of this place.
When all those years ago I walked out of this campus with my degree certificates and my ambitions, I did not know that I would one day be invited to deliver the convocation address to an audience as distinguished as this. I believe my presence on this podium today is evidence of the abiding possibilities of life. And coming back here today, after so many years, I am reminded of the debt of gratitude I owe to the visionaries who first conceived of the idea of this institution and worked to make it a reality. I salute them, and I'm grateful to the Pro-Chancellor, Senator Dr. Larry Tejosho, the Vice-Chancellor, Professor Toyin Ogunipe, and all those who have made this day possible. I also salute all the men and women who labored through the years to sustain the institution in a tradition of excellence. Your hard work and resilience are why the University of Lagos remains the university of first choice and the nation's pride. I have been asked today to speak on the subject, Building Back Better, Creating a New Framework for Tertiary Education in Nigeria in the 21st Century. The way I see it, I should first assess the conditions of tertiary education in Nigeria. And following that, I will try to articulate the specific actions necessary to bridge the gap so our tertiary institutions can compete favorably in the 21st century. But first, let me begin by asking, what is the purpose of education? In his classic poem, The Georgics, Virgil, the ancient Roman poet, wrote, "Fortunate who was able to know the causes of things." Now, this simple poetic turn of phrase is a powerful call to engage in the constant inquiry to understand the foundational truths that underpin our understanding of the world, motivate our practices, and inspire our actions. Evidently, one purpose of education is to empower the individual to embark on a voyage of discovery that leads to clarity. But the question is that the sole purpose? Professor Nike Ijaya, I'm sure you all know of her, of the University of Ilorin posits the intention of education is to equip the child as early as possible with the knowledge, values, and skills he needs to navigate this complex world for the sake of his own comfort and of society. Professor Ijaya's formulation aligns with that of Dr. Martin Luther King, who we also all know very well. And he wrote in 1947 that education has a twofold function to perform in the life of man and the society. The one is utility, and the other is culture. Education must enable a man to become more efficient, to achieve with increasing facility the legitimate goals of his life. Education must also train one for quick, resolute, and effective thinking. Now, central to all of these formulations is the idea that the primary purpose of education is to improve the individual in mind and empower them to be beneficial to themselves and to the society. A good education should produce an individual confident of his or her own abilities, capable of logical thought, aware of his own shortcomings, but not constrained by them, cognizant of his rights and of his responsibilities within the community. To these, I will add that a good education produces citizens invested in the progress and well-being of their society, and who have the wherewithal to take positive action to those societies better, to make those societies better. The well-educated citizen in this paradigm understands his society, thinks logically about its problems, without being overwhelmed by half-truths, prejudices, and propaganda, and is therefore able to make informed and valid contributions to the administration and progress of that society. Now, when we think about education policy, when we consider laws and implement directives relating to education in our country, particularly tertiary education of which we speak today, our highest objective must be to deliver an educational system capable of producing the archetype of an individual. When we consider the problems of education infrastructure, access to education opportunities, quality of instruction, the welfare of teachers, lecturers, and professors, we will do well to remember that all of these factors matter only to the extent that they are necessary to build institutions that produce citizens who can advance the cause of Nigeria. Let's not make a mistake about this. Our world has changed. The old certainties from which we derived assurance and built our expectations no longer exist. The value of the extractive industries that have powered our economy has deteriorated. It continues to do so rapidly as technological advances lead us towards a future where coal, crude, and gas are replaced by renewable alternatives of solar, wind, and water. For Nigerian citizens to thrive in this new world and to participate fully and productively in the new global economy and benefit from rather than be consumed by the technological advancements that are changing our world, tertiary education in Nigeria must be prepared to embrace reinvention and adapt to disruption. The Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria guarantees the fundamental right to dignity of the human person. In a digital age where socioeconomic participation is based on intellectual ability and access to information, a purposeful and well-rounded education is a fundamental human right because the individual's ability to participate fully in society depends almost entirely on the quality of education available to them. Now, I say human right, and sometimes I even elevate it to the status of fundamental human right, because sometimes people make the mistake, and we're very prone to do this, all over the world, not just in Nigeria, that education is sometimes considered to be a privilege. Perhaps maybe it was at one time. But today, it is a non-negotiable fundamental human right. Unfortunately, it is still the case that the foundations of our education system are rooted in a different age and designed to meet the social, economic, and labor demands of a different societal and economic model. As the world has changed, which I stated earlier, we have not done enough in government, in academia, and in society to adjust our education and our skills. We need to adjust our skills acquisition system to meet these new realities. Now, how do we move from our present circumstances? What does this moment require of us? That is the ultimate question. Yes, we are where we are. But what does this moment require of us to leapfrog and to move? Together with the Committee of Nations and the advanced world, for me, it requires first that we be honest about the scale of challenges that we face. I'm sure you've all heard people say honesty is the best policy. Honesty about the scale of the challenges we face and the realities of our present circumstances free us to engage in the sort of radical thinking and innovation that would have been considered taboo just a few years ago. Most national policy discussions of higher education focus on structure and financing. Understandably so. However, there are essential issues of curriculum, teaching methods, assessment, and fairness that should engage our minds to be part of any reform proposition. Wholesale reviews of our curricula and teaching methods to situate our practices in the context of global labor needs to be the barest minimum. Now, this does not take away from the need to institute a program of aggressive and sustained investment in the physical infrastructure of classrooms and lecture halls and technology hardware and software to facilitate information exchange and innovation. Very recently, and I think the Vice Chancellor alluded to this when he was making his remarks cum lecture. The world has had to cope with the unforeseen effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, and our education system has not been spared. A natural alteration of the 2020 academic calendar became imminent. I've been made to understand that the University of Lagos, under the leadership of the Vice Chancellor, Professor Toyin Ogudipe, was the first public tertiary institution to adopt virtual learning in quick response to the disruption occasioned by the COVID-19 lockdown. This great institution conducted lectures, examinations, and even the post-UTME virtually. Free data was also made available to students. Hence, ICT rescued the academic calendar of our institution. Now, this is the kind of radical thinking and innovation needed in our citadels of learning. Tertiary institutions in Nigeria need to develop a new understanding of the changing nature of work and the future of employment, and allow this new understanding to inform the nature of instruction and the substance of the education they provide. Collaboration between our higher institutions and the organized private sector is vital in this regard, so that we can jointly rise to the demands of the moment. Wealth creation and value addition in the 21st century flow from enterprises that take advantage of emerging opportunities to expand the frontiers of innovation. In this new system, a qualitative tertiary education should empower young people to be entrepreneurial in their thinking and in how they navigate their chosen careers. Therefore, tertiary education in Nigeria must include entrepreneurship training and promote vocational skills as a feature of all courses and programs. Now, across the world, a symbiotic twinning of academia with the private sector has allowed the creation of knowledge hubs that drive innovation and education and economic advancement. I'll give you a quick example. California Stanford University has become both the training ground for Silicon Valley's elite and the beneficiary of enormous contributions in manpower, financial resources, and networking opportunities that have turned the institution into a powerhouse for the ages. So I've often wondered, sometimes aloud, that why similar arrangements have not been recreated in our environment. If it's good for Stanford, it's good for the University of Lagos. We can all easily agree that many universities in the country, private and public, would benefit significantly from such close contact with private sector energy, practice, and resources. What then mitigates against this level of close collaboration? These are the questions we need to ponder upon. Is it the existing laws? Is it reluctance on the university's part of the or the organized private sector itself? These are some of the questions we must ask and answer as we seek to reposition tertiary education in Nigeria to meet the demands of a changing world. One area where we already have the basic framework for collaboration is the industrial attachment program. What we now need is to identify ways to improve on this program. Tertiary institutions of learning should identify and partner with private sector organizations to provide practical experience for students as part of their academic training throughout their course. Now, what this will do is it will significantly improve the current practice of requiring students to undergo this portion of their training in organizations that do not allow them to get the full benefit of the experience. Advancing our tertiary institutions into the 21st century demands that we do whatever is required in terms of changes to legislation, regulation, or to policy to achieve this sort of closer synergy between the private sector and our educational and training institutions. For the sake of our nation's future, we cannot leave the ideals of building back better for the government alone to pursue. Let me repeat, for the sake of our future, we cannot leave the ideals of building back better for government alone to pursue. It's not done anywhere in the world. Even as we look outward, we must consider the possibilities for extensive and multi-dimensional collaboration with academia, keeping in mind that the objective is to improve productivity. Tertiary institutions need to engage with the possibility of integrating university courses across departments and disciplines, such as merging law with economics and technology, medicine with engineering and accounting, media with governance and administration, and other such partnerships that sound weird because we're not thinking outside the box. We're used to those stereotypes, those basic law, medicine. No, there must be cross-discipline partnership. And what does this do? It broadens the horizon. It expands the knowledge base of the student and prepares him for much flexibility and dexterity to do things that he would ordinarily not be able to do if he had been restricted into a straitjacket in one particular discipline. We must also consider statutory and operational reforms to encourage closer collaboration between tertiary institutions, public and private. Today, our tertiary institutions exist and operate primarily in independent silos. Alternative to this is an approach wherein tertiary institutions work as part of an interdependent network to establish a collaborative research and development ecosystem, training and resource sharing. Multidimensional collaborations will increasingly be the key to building modern tertiary institutions in Nigeria, capable of holding their own in the modern education system. And then there is the issue of how we finance tertiary education in Nigeria, the all-important issue of finance. This is an area of much controversy. However, two things remain true. The first is that building the kind of institutions we need and desire will require significant investments. And the second is that the current approach is neither adequate nor sustainable, as it heavily depends on subventions from the federal and state governments. Therefore, I believe that we must agree to use the instruments of policy and legislation to advance a new framework for funding tertiary education in our country. And yes, my Lord, what I say I will do, I will do. Ideally, this new system should provide funding for all students who qualify, so that the burden of school fees and living expenses can be deferred and paid over a period of time. It's a no-brainer. And it's something that happens all over the world, at least in advanced democracies. It must also ensure that the institutions get paid for their services so that resources are available to operate effectively. Now, a little anecdote here, something very dear to my heart. As a politician, one of the most frequent requests I receive is for funding to meet the needs of students who are unable to fund their tertiary education. Students who are otherwise, you speak to them for just a minute, you find out how brilliant their mind is. And the education is cut short just because they do not have the necessary economic wherewithal to advance that education. It's the biggest request I get as a politician from people, my constituents and even those outside my constituents. Now, this is an ongoing problem that puts us at a risk of losing some of the brightest young minds in our country. A well-structured student loan system is one way to do this. This already exists in many parts of the world, like I said earlier. And we can borrow from best practices to deliver a system that meets our unique needs. In the National Assembly, we're working on the Students' Loan Access to Higher Education Bill, which I sponsored. This bill will establish the framework for providing interest-free loans to students, with repayment of these loans beginning 2 years after the completion of the National Youth Service and spread over time. So the loan, which establishes an education bank, will be interest-free, a moratorium of 2 years, upon completion of the youth service program. Reason being that we expect that given 2 years after youth service, hopefully, more likely than not, the student will get a job and will be able to repay spread over time. Now we will continue that effort until we successfully design a system that addresses our concerns and meets our needs in our own unique way as a country. However, we must all understand that public support for any such system will depend significantly on the tertiary institutions themselves. As I said before, tertiary education costs money all over the world. The reason why people nonetheless persist in paying these huge sums is that the value proposition is evident. Tertiary institutions in Nigeria must also be prepared to make the value of their services clear to students and parents alike. In a world where an undergraduate with technical computing skills can provide services to the global market from their bedroom and earn significant sums in exchange, a degree certificate by itself doesn't hold the same value it once did. We must recognize this reality and act with that in mind. The Ninth House of Representatives has education as one of its key areas of focus in its legislative agenda. We term that legislative agenda our contract with Nigerians. And that was a deliberate choice of words. We termed it a contract with Nigerians. So that we set the bar and place benchmarks and boxes besides everything we have said we will do. And so that at the end of our 4-year tenure, Nigerians can tick the boxes and determine whether we have done what we said we would do in that legislative agenda, which is a public document, by the way, and which is available to everyone. We intend to be held by that. We are, for instance, taking active steps to upgrade many of our public institutions, elevating some colleges of education to universities of education, amongst others. This has increased the employability and viability of research work in our country. Recently, the House intervened in the face-off between the federal government and the Academic Staff Union of Universities to avert a strike action. That intervention also led to the recent approval of the University Transparency and Accountability Solution, UTAS, for the payment of lecturers in Nigerian universities. Ladies and gentlemen, I, as a person, I have always been passionate about education. Education is the silver bullet that cuts through most of our national challenges. Now, people, there's a common phrase, there is no silver bullet. But education is that silver bullet that cuts across through most of our national challenges. Think about it. We believe no child should be left behind or denied the opportunity to receive the freedom that a good education provides. As a legislator, I have put considerable emphasis on policies and interventions to improve education access and quality. As part of that effort, I have provided educational grants for selected students from my Surulere 1 federal constituency, studying in public tertiary institutions. And of course, that includes the University of Lagos. I have worked to attract infrastructure development projects to tertiary institutions in Lagos State, including the free Wi-Fi facilities in 6 public tertiary institutions in Lagos State, a dedicated international students hostel here in the University of Lagos, as the Vice Chancellor mentioned, and amongst other such infrastructural development. As we depart this hall, I will proceed to the College of Medicine of this same University of Lagos for the foundation laying of a new medical outpatient center for the benefit of Luth, Idiaraba, and members of the public. Teachers and students are the greatest beneficiary of our educational intervention projects in my constituency. We have provided modern ICT centers in 12 schools, and we are still constructing more. Just as we are renovating many schools at primary and secondary levels, providing instructional materials for ease of learning and e-learning tablets and laptops for teachers and students in the constituency. And we'll continue to do more in revamping our educational system. Sustainable reform cannot be imposed from the outside. For reform to be effective and for it to be long-lasting, it must come from within the institutions. More than financing and curriculum technology, more than teaching methods, there is a fundamental question of fairness that our higher institutions continue to contend with and must address before we can hope to have them participate fully and profitably in the global community of education and innovation. Let's talk about the very sensitive subject of sexual harassment. We have a problem with harassment and victimization in our higher institutions. We must call it what it is. And this is not a problem of a few bad eggs spoiling the whole bunch. No, it's not. It is a consequence of weak institutional mechanisms susceptible to egregious abuse by those for whom power is not a call to service, but an opportunity to take more than they are entitled to and sacrifice the future of others on the altar of their own base desires. We cannot aspire to build 21st century institutions capable of competing effectively in the global space when this issue remains a recurring cause for concern. And we will not solve this problem through occasional purges brought on by external denunciations in the press or on social media, but by reconstructing how tertiary institutions operate as a matter of course. So therefore, ladies and gentlemen, I propose that we adopt across the board a system of zero tolerance for individuals, students or staff who are credibly accused of harassment, intimidation, and any infringement of individual autonomy. Let it be the role of the independent panels made up of persons of integrity and unquestionable authority to educate the credibility and interrogate the genuineness of complaints, taking only relevant variables into consideration, and after that, proposing a course of action to which the university must be bound. Our universities must be places of learning and innovation where people feel safe and where injustice in all its forms has no place. The summary of it all is very simple. Where we are is not where we ought to be. Moving from here requires a concerted and collaborative effort between government, our tertiary institutions, and stakeholders from the worlds of business and philanthropy to pursue new approaches. The country is faced with yet another election in 2023. Before the 2019 general elections, we amended the Constitution of our Republic to reduce age restrictions for elective offices so that more eligible young people can participate in the politics and governance of our country. Last year, I had hoped that as part of the Electoral Act Amendment Bill, we could effect the direct primary method as a procedure for nominating candidates by political parties. Direct primary elections give every registered member of a political party the right to choose the candidates to represent the party in elections. It is inclusive, not exclusive. Over time, this method has proved to be the most effective way of expanding citizen participation in the party nomination and leadership recruitment process. We are now in the process of sampling the diverse views on how to move forward with the Electoral Act Amendment Bill. And I expect that these and other issues will be resolved soon when we get back to the House this week. I also believe that the time has come for us to agree to review Section 131, Subsection D of the 1999 Constitution to increase the minimum educational qualification for persons aspiring to political office in Nigeria. We cannot, on one hand, be talking about raising the standard of education in Nigeria, and on the other hand, requiring the barest minimum for those who will govern us. The Constitution, as it is today, requires a secondary school certificate or its equivalent as the minimum academic qualification for higher political office. This is the requirement for qualification to contest for governor, national assembly, or president. Ladies and gentlemen, this provision is the product of a different time and reflects the reality of that time. It is time to take another look at that position as part of the ongoing effort to reform our electoral system and establish a fully participatory democracy, providing the capable leadership honors the dedication and diligence of the graduates who have completed their course of study and will today be sent forth to go and make their way in this brave new world. I congratulate you all, most heartily, on your achievement. You have the good fortune to be graduating at a time of great uncertainty in the world. And many will ask, what is this guy talking about? How can he say that we have the good fortune to be graduating at a time of great uncertainty in the world? What's so good about that fortune? Well, this is a historic moment fraught with opportunity and peril brought on by advancements in technology, accelerated globalization, and the reformation of the global economic and political order. And you are fortunate because throughout recorded history, it is in times such as this that men and women of talent and ability make their name and build their fortunes. Check out the records, check out your history. It is at times like this that men and women with talent and ability make their name, their mark, and build their fortunes. And that's why I said, you're fortunate. As you enter the world, allow me to share a few lessons I have learned on my own journey over the nearly four decades since I sat where you now sit. And I hope that these lessons will guide you to achieve your highest potential. First, to thine own self be true. You will be called on to take tough decisions and make hard choices in your life's journey. What you do in those circumstances has to be based on an absolute conviction in your spirit. It is that conviction that will give you the courage to stand by the principles you hold dear, even when no one else does. To quote the late Steve Jobs, who we all know, don't let the noise of other opinions drown out your own inner voice. Let me repeat. Don't let the noise of others' opinions drown out your own inner voice. Following that, you must, as the words of John Wesley, now listen to me carefully, very carefully, do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. All the achievements of your life, however grand they may be, and I'm sure they're very grand, or they will be grand, they will amount to naught if in the full accounting you haven't done enough to make this world even just a little better for others. Let empathy and the kindness that flow from it be your legacy in this world. Education is the key to freedom. I've always believed that. Yet it is the hallmark of the educated mind to recognize that your education is not enough. And from that recognition, devote yourself to lifelong learning. Do not close your mind to the possibilities that exist. All things are to be examined and called into question. All things. If you do this, you will light a candle of understanding in your heart, which shall never be put out. Having toiled night and day for many years, you have earned the tools you need to participate in the world. Now you must go out there and carve out your place at the table, and eventually at the head of the table. Do not allow yourself to fall into the trap of thinking that having earned your degree, the world now owes you something. No. It doesn't. The world owes you nothing. Nothing will be handed to you. Everything must be achieved with the same hard work and dedication that has carried you to this moment. But here's the good news. The world is your oyster. Go out and eat it. I congratulate you once more, graduates, and I salute all the friends and family, guardians and supporters who have contributed in one form or the other to the success we have gathered to celebrate today. Go forth and succeed. Thank you for listening. God bless you. God bless University of Lagos, and God bless the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Please let's be seated. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, that was the guest lecture from our guest lecturer, Honorable Femi Gbajabiamila, Speaker of the House of Representatives, Federal Republic of Nigeria. Please let's give it up for him once more. At this point, I'll call on the chairperson, the chairman, for our closing remarks. Honorable Justice Amina Adamu Augie, CON, Justice of the Supreme Court, Federal Republic of Nigeria, man.
Okay, I'm back again to close. I was teasing him. I said, well, it looked like I knew what he was going to say, and I prepared the way for him to go and say it, and he said it, and he has publicly promised all of us that everything he said is going to work on. And we will hold him up to his promise, but I believe that he will do what he wants to say. Now, in closing remarks, I want to thank everybody, thank all of you. I know somebody is going to go say the vote of thanks, but I want all of us, those listening out there, those of us here, to realize, to hold on to that thought that, that what we do with ourselves, educating ourselves, making us ready to face what life has to come, is our personal choice. Nobody is forcing you. Nobody's going to say do or don't do. But when you do get yourself groundly, properly and soundly education, everything's like a vehicle that will take you to the highest point ever. If you don't get it ready and you're sitting down there, you'll never be able to get across the place. Now, I want to end by, I want to at least talk about, yesterday we had to go to a Thanksgiving event at Redeemed Church in Aja. And I walked in, I saw the pastor here today, but he said something that resonated with all of us there. He was talking about how, he has all the biblical thing, but more or less saying that what seems so uncertain, chaotic, as if impossible to that can happen today, but we don't know what tomorrow will come and how things changed. And then he used the example of, I hope you do know how the British government have been sending aircraft to carry our nurses, our doctors, physiotherapists, all the health officials. So the message he was trying to tell the congregation was that it's not impossible, go now and start studying, make sure you have the certificate. But I want to talk about those ones that had them. Because he made a point to say that they go there, they give them visa on arrival. And he says, there are people who could wait how many years at the visa office trying to beg to get a visa, killing themselves to get visas. These people were seated, but they had their certificates in their hands. So when it came time, when God said it was time, they are now being begged to say, please come and help us out. So this is a lesson to all of us to say that at any moment in time, may we be ready for what it is that we need to do with the certificates that we have got. But be ready. Make sure you do get that education so that you are ready for it. So I hope that we have at least made the points that others will take home, resonate with them also, and know that tomorrow may change. Right now, COVID, all kinds of things can happen. But those who make billions, those who make money, are those who take risks. If you check history, if you read autobiographies, it's those who at the moment of, it's like saying like in an earthquake, gold that was buried, diamonds hidden somewhere comes out. It's at times like that, that those who take risks now make so much money that comes out there. So we don't know what tomorrow we may bring that will suddenly in front of you open up and you find out that all you were studying and getting ready for was for this moment. When I talk to people, when I talk to students and everybody, or anybody I talk to, I tell them that you see this thing about preparing for that day. I'm waiting for that day where I will be in the public glare or anything like that. I tell them, I said, if you look back, if you check your stage, wherever you are on a stage, may be that place. Wherever you're walking in life, you don't know that you're walking on a stage because suddenly you're standing there, and if you're inside a room, this wall falls, the one this side falls, the one behind falls, and then you're standing there. And you're being asked, like me now. I don't know why I was asked to come and share, but I didn't know what I was going to say. What I asked myself was, how did I get here? I did my master's in Unilag here. I went to Great Ife. That's the history. Great Ife, yes, you know. So, but I did my master's here. And I was going through the gate. I was telling the protocol officer, I said, which gate are we going to use? Because when I was a student here, we had to use the back gate to be able to get in time. So I was asking myself, how now did I get here where I have to chair a convocation lecture? When I was being given my gown, the guy in charge of gowns, chairman, the gown for the chairman, and he's just looking, the guy said, the chairman, he says, oh, I'm so used to the chairman being a man, I didn't expect. I'm standing there waiting for my, he said, oh, I'm so used to it being men. I didn't expect that it's a woman that will be a chairman this year. But what does that say? What does that say? That if I have worked all my life, done everything, I'm 68, And at 68, they say, okay, you're going to, all that you've done, you're going to now have to speak today. And all I ask God is, please, God, let me be ready to say what it is that you want me to say. Just speak through me. Speak through me, because at this point, how I got here, I don't know. So please, 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 let us take home that the students have to realize you have to teach your children, you have to talk to your students, you have to prepare them, primary school from everywhere. Education is your personal choice. It is for your future. As Justice Augie is standing here, may it be that one day I will be standing there. Not that you will just, you know, if we talk about planting seeds, and then some just grow a bit, wither away and die. Some actually take root and grow into huge trees. I don't want to be like a weed that will dry up tomorrow and be swept. No, I want to be that tree that will grow, provide shade, provide fruit, provide everything until the day I say that I'm going. It's a choice. So if you choose to misuse your time in school, if you choose to do what you should, you know, the brilliance that you have, those who are hacking, those who are doing all these things, it's the same brain, and that's what the pastor said. It's the same brain that you're using. Instead of using it positively, you're now using it negatively. Turn it into something good that it will be spoken of you good, not that you end up, we send so many, well, I send so many people to prison. But, we sentenced to death. When I tell people we have the power in our hands, you know, you see judges and you're pushing them away. One day, your life, your property, your liberty, all I have to do is sign a pen. I sign a pen, I take your life, I take your property, and I take your everything. So, I mean, we have the power, but we're sitting down there. Do you want to be able to have that power tomorrow? Would you want to be able to change people's lives positively? Would you want to add value at whatever position in life that you are? Add value, not to poison the environment, not to poison everywhere, not to lead people astray, not to lead them to walk in evil ways. It's a choice, and it starts with what? A proper and sound education. So I wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, in our usual way, we will be acknowledging the guest lecturer, and so permit me to call on our Pro-Chancellor, aided by our Vice-Chancellor, to do the presentation of gifts to our guest lecturer. And so I have the privilege to call our Pro-Chancellor, the Vice-Chancellor, and the guest speaker to please come so that they can do officially gifting. Please let's encourage them and give them a round of applause as they come.
Corporate gift for the convocation lecturer, Honorable Olufemi Akinbaja, BML, Speaker of the House of Representatives, titled Shita Surulere, a panoramic picture showing Shita Akerele, Alhaji Marshall Road, Teslim Balogun Stadium, Anambra.
Let me call on the chairperson.
My lord, man.
You better be careful the way you say my lord, so that she will not sign you out. A corporate gift for the chairperson of this convocation lecture, Honorable Justice Amina Adamu Uge, CON, Justice of the Supreme Court of Nigeria, titled National Arts Theatre Igomu. The picture captures the theatre in its form, the exterior part of it, with the light rail station behind it. National Theatre was designed by architect Stefan Kolche.
Thank you very much. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure it has been a beautiful day, and it is such a beautiful way to start our convocation ceremonies. Let me remind us once again that this is our 52nd convocation lecture, starting and kicking off the 52nd convocation ceremonies. We have quickly come to the end of the lecture. And let me call on the Registrar of University of Lagos, Aziz Oladejo Esquire, for the vote of thanks. Please let's give him a round of applause.
The chairman of this occasion, our Pro-Chancellor and Chairman of Governing Council, the 12th Vice-Chancellor of the University of Lagos, our distinguished guest lecturer, ladies and gentlemen, in the last 1.5 hours, we have all listened to an excellent analysis of the challenges of tertiary education in Nigeria by the Speaker of House of Representatives, Right Honorable Femi Gbajabi Amila. Permit me, distinguished audience, to commence this vote of thanks by first congratulating the Pro-Chancellor and Chairman of Council, distinguished Senator Prince Dr. Olanrewaju Teji Osho, and our amiable Vice-Chancellor, Professor Oluwatoyin Temitayo Ogundipe FAS, for painstakingly assisted this audience by going for the caliber of the guest lecturer of today and our amiable chairman. It is on this note that I want to thank the chairman of this occasion on behalf of the management of the University of Lagos, Milord Justice Amina Adamu Arugi, CON, for sacrificing the precious time as a justice of the Apex Court of Nigeria to come to our alma mater, the University of Lagos, today. Applause for the chairman. We're also grateful to the Honorable Speaker of the House of Representatives for also finding time out of his busy schedule to deliver the 52nd convocation lecture of the University of First Choice and the nation's pride, the University of Lagos. Applause for the Speaker of House of Lords. The Speaker is here with so many dignities of the House of Representatives, too many to mention. But permit me, distinguished audience, to single out two of them for mentioning. First is the Chairman, House Committee on Tertiary Education and Services, Dr. Aminu Sulaiman. Thank you very much, sir, for coming. The Chairman, House Committee on Defense is also here with me. He's also here in this hall. Thank you very much, sir. Permit me also to acknowledge the contributions of members of management of the University of Lagos who have been supporting the Vice Chancellor in the past 4 years. Deputy Vice Chancellor of Academies and Research, Professor Oluwole Familoni FAS, we thank you. Deputy Vice Chancellor of Development Services, Professor Ayodele Asenua, thank you very much for standing by the Vice Chancellor. Deputy Vice Chancellor, Management Services, Professor Lucien Obinachukwu, we are very grateful to you. The Bursar of the University, Dr. Lale Kanawa, thank you very much for making money available all the time. Our university librarian, and the first person to be appointed a university professor in the University of Lagos, Professor Yetunde Zaid, we are so much grateful to you. In management also is the Provost College of Medicine, University of Lagos, Idiaraba, Professor David Adewale, okay, thank you so much, sir. The Director of Academic Planning is also there in management, Professor Mukolola Olusakin. Thank you, ma, for supporting the Vice Chancellor. I also want to thank the Director of Quality Assurance and Savicom, Professor Grace Otiwa, for her efforts in management, in moving the University of Lagos forward. Since Saturday, members of the Governing Council of the University of Lagos have been meeting to deliberate on so many matters concerning staff welfare. Here in this hall, our federal government appointees of council, Dr. Aminu Ahmed, we thank you for your support to our great university. Chief Tina Adindu, we thank you, sir, for your efforts. Comrade Mustafa Saliu, we also thank you, sir. In the hall with us, so are also internal members of council who are representing various inter groups and stakeholders within the university. Professor Bola Obo, we are grateful to you, ma. Professor Lukemi Odukoya, thank you very much. Professor Solomon Akinboye, we thank you, sir. And representing the congregation, Oluwa Rotimi Sodimu Eskaya, thank you very much for your contribution to council. Again, Professor Owolabi Latif Kuye, we thank you. The former Deputy Governor of Lagos State is also here with us. We thank you very much, sir, for attending this occasion. And also the Deputy Governor of Ogun State, we are grateful to you. The distinguished scholars who constitute the Senate of the University of Lagos deserve to be praised. Words are not enough to thank you for your efforts in ensuring that this convocation ceremony holds today. Thank you, members of Senate of the University. We are also blessed to have emeritus professors, distinguished professors, past deputy vice chancellors who have served this university meritoriously for so many decades in this hall. We are grateful to you all for attending this convocation lecture. Deans of faculty, heads of departments and units who are also toiling day and night to make the university the best in the world, we are grateful to you. Permit me to also appreciate the immediate past registrar of this university, Dr. Taiwo Folasade Paye, FNIM, who is now Director of Tombanefo Digital Research Center, for finding time to attend this occasion. We are grateful to you, ma. The chairman and members of the ceremonies committee of this university who have put this occasion together is led by Professor Mike Adebamowo of the Department of Architecture. We are grateful to you, sir. Gentlemen of the press, traditional rulers, union leaders, members of staff generally in registry, BOSTI, audit, works and physical planning, CITS, security, international school, star school, and several others. We are grateful for the various efforts you are putting in into the system to ensure that your university remains the best. Do remember that this convocation ceremony will continue tomorrow and will last till Friday. We expect you all to be here to witness this occasion. And as you come, please observe COVID-19 protocol. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all for coming and wish you the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the lecture. I will crave your indulgence that after we take the closing prayers, we'll take the university anthem, followed by the national anthem. And you will please allow the people on the podium to process out before we follow them. Thank you very much. Professor Musa, will please come to give us the closing prayer, sir.
Shall we pray? A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa in lam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. In the name of Allah, the beneficent, the merciful. We thank Allah, the all-knowing, the most wise. We thank you for the blessings you have bestowed on this nation. We thank you for your numerous mercies on this university. We thank you for these convocation ceremonies that has successfully commenced. Oh Allah, we thank you that as we start this ceremony, you will stay with us throughout. Grant us honor. Grant us success. Grant us victory. We thank you for the lecture delivered by Honorable Abdulhakim Bajabi Amila. It's an asset to this nation. It's also an asset to the University of Lagos. Oh Allah, continue to inspire him. He has more to offer. Grant him the wherewithal to be able to do more for this university and for this country. As we leave here to come back tomorrow, continue to be our nourisher and sustainer. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Thank you very much, sir. Please can we stand for the university anthem, followed by the national anthem. Thank you.
people on the podium to take the procession out. Thank you very much.
By no other but a great alumnus of our university, the University of Lagos, University of First Choice and National Pride. You hear him and you heard him here first. It's about trying to do things better, trying to see the best possible ways how to education. It concerns the 21st century. And then, of course, there were several solutions that he created, that he preferred, that we can actually adopt, you know, moving forward as a nation. And what the lawmaking body talking about, the House of Representatives, and of course, perhaps the Senate, would do and look inwards to see how exactly how they can make things work
in the next couple of years for those that are coming then. And I think without that, we can begin to look at the very meaning of how education would definitely shape up our economy. We cannot overemphasize the importance of education. We cannot, you know, undermine also the importance of education in whatsoever way you're looking at it. And of course, the University of Lagos has been able to identify these particular areas and best possible ways, and people who, of course, are eminent personalities to come look at critical issues that are nationally discussed and, of course, internationally also of concern, to see how best we can, you know, shape, of course, you know, change our narrative. And I'm quite glad that you all enjoyed it. If there are feedbacks for us, I think you all can go on all our social media platforms, like we read out in the interview. You go through on all our social media handles, talking about Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and of course, go on YouTube to actually give comment, because we are being live in ensuring that you get all of the details, all of the happenings across the convocation ceremony. It's still the studio of the 2020 Unilag Convocation Ceremonies, and we're quite glad to have you still joining us on today's program of event. In another moment from now, we're taking a very short break, and we have host of people to talk to us. In the morning, we indeed had exhibitors who were, of course, at the stand, and of course, the Honorable Speaker of the House of Representatives had opportunities to go around with some other, you know, top dignitaries that graced this occasion, and we're able to actually get, you know, footages and, you know, what's it called now, live feeds of some of these, you know, exhibitions that went down earlier today. And we have some of them who are more like those who can give, you know, an insight into some of the things we saw in the morning. And this is what we're doing just right at about this time. Don't forget, it's hashtag the Unilag 2020 Convocation Ceremony. If you are, of course, part of this success, we are, of course, beaming live at the University of Lagos Television. And my name once again is Barasala. We're going for a very short breather. When we come back, it will be time for us to experience firsthand what the exhibition we send the money are all about. And then we have all of our people who to talk to us just here to come and give us insight at some of the things to expect. We'll be right back after this break. What? Yeah, time's up. Okay, that's good, yeah. By the way, is it beaming? Is it beaming? Let's kill the audio.
can't hear anything now. But
welcome back for a very short breather. And of course, at this moment, I'm being joined by a very astute academic and one of those who have actually been up there, you know, behind the scenes, making things work. You know, we talk about the University of Lagos having to be in the headlines just for the right reasons, the positive the past year. And without doubt, research and innovation have been top-notch. He's been just on top of the ratings. And of course, entrepreneurship, like it was once mentioned, or it's been mentioned earlier during the lecture of the Right Honourable Speaker of the House of Representatives. And then permit me to actually introduce to you the Deputy Director of the Research Innovation Office, University of Lagos, Dr. Gwenda Lowe. It's a great pleasure to have you, ma'am, on the show. All right,
there's something that seems to be bugging at the moment.
It's about the research
at the University of Lagos.
Without doubt, I mean, it seems to have been got hold of billions. We heard the license
a couple of moments ago talk about how research has been able to shape, you know, as the ratings of the university. How have been able to do all of that?
What takes determination?
So first, we've been able to sensitize the now. But now there's so much drive to let everybody know that without research we are nothing. Because before now people just drive to have number, a few numbers of paper required to get to the bar, to the professorial level, and that is all. But now the drive is towards how much grant you are able to bring to your team as a researcher. So it's not just about the number of publications, but also the grants that you are able to bring. The advantage of that is we are using our research. The research cannot be limited to what you do to write papers. It should be what you do to solve societal problems.
Mm.
So that is the drive now. We want you to get grants, because the limited funds we have within will not be able to achieve that goal. So that is the drive towards getting external grants that can actually make our research more impactful, can actually help to solve
the
societal problem.
I remember now just asking you how you to do this. Intricately, in trying to solve this problem, the societal problems, I think sometime last year, I was also privileged to understand
that there is also a call
for the
non-teaching educator to of course be part of the research
drive. Two members of our staff also were able to win grant. Beyond this, I think we took it a step further by adding to, you know, create a kind of culture of bringing research administrators among the administrators together. Do you want to tell us exactly how that is? Because for me, I would have said that by now we should have been able to see, you know, what these administrators should be doing at the moment. Of course, a lot of them, through the training, were able to understand what they're expected to do. But from your own angle, how exactly do you think, how early do you think we start feeling the impact of these administrators, and how do you think we collaborate with the goal you just rightly mentioned that you said you have in
sight? Also, aside traditional R&D activities, we also do capacity building in that office.
Okay.
Do the innovation of it. So that's why you see that non-traditional researchers that we used to do it are included in the drive. And one of the problems we have in this society is we want to see changes now and now. We do not want to wait for the process.
The process is going to take a while to start seeing the changes in our society. You won't see it drive. Of course, we
train
a few of them who are to come back to impact their society, to
change the culture,
to change the narrative. So it will take a while for you to start seeing the impact. It's not going to be immediate, because this is things that we've not been used to over the years. And the culture is just like, we thank God for the VC who is so passionate about this.
And so it will take a while.
I can tell you,
in the 5 years ago, if you look at the grants that we bring to
university is not as what happened now. So we can see that everybody's catching the fire now.
Okay, I want to, of course, use this medium to express our profound gratitude to the Vice Chancellor for his research and innovation drive, for the many things we've been able to put into place at the University of Lagos. Without doubt, we've been able to actually be the front burner just for the right reasons. I want to say a big thank you for having to come in the program. Thank you so much for coming on. We'll be a very short break, and when we come back, we'll take our next guest on the show. We'll be right back. welcome back. It's still the 2020 Unilag Convocation Ceremony, and here we are at the University of Lagos Television Convocation Studios. By the way, we've actually said to you earlier during the course of the day the need for you to be interactive with us, because we can only get better. And the only thing that I want to put this out there for all of you out there is for all you to understand all the nitty-gritty, the interviews, the Edward interviews as it is, and of course all of the back rooms, and of course all the throughs and throughs that we have around the convocation ceremony. And I'm quite glad to announce to you at this point in time that we've got a big fish to actually talk to us, because it's still the University of Lagos 2020 convocation ceremony. It's my pleasure to welcome here with me in the studio the Pro-Chancellor and the Chairman of the Governing Council, University of Lagos, Distinguished Senator, Prince Dr. Larry Tejisho. My pleasure to have you on set, sir. So it's actually started last week. I mean, we busy around this event with the World Press Conference. A lot of things were said. Today there's been a continuum of some of the achievements in the last 1 year. But beyond this, it's also gratifying to note that some very giant strides they made under your watch as the chairman of the council. Do you want to tell exactly how you've been able to achieve this in the space of a few months you assumed the office?
Thank you very much. I don't think I need to look too far, or that is aim too far to answer that question. You can see what happened today, the very glorious event of today. I was enjoying myself from beginning until the Vice Chancellor announced that he was leaving this year. Because before I think of what I want to do or what I should contribute to any event or program, the Vice Chancellor would have done it. So it's made me kind of redundant, happily. I'm very happy because we think alike, and I mean, I always congratulate him after the, from last year convocation. So it has been an issue of joint intervention, honesty of purpose, and we think of the institution first before we think of ourselves. So whatever we are trying to do is how we want to elevate the university, not to elevate ourselves. So, and of course, we have very bright minds in the council. The management, I mean, I think we should give it to them. They are doing a very good job. So we thank God for putting all of us together.
I think I'm also quite certain about the things you've mentioned about the Vice Chancellor. Without doubt, when you use the word honest of purpose, it's a very strong word. And just a few moments ago, I remember the Speaker of the House of Representatives was also mentioning things about having to change anything as his policy, you know, in changing the narrative, you have to be honest about everything. And one of such instances, just the setting up of this, this happened at instance. It was just something that was discussed last week. Mr. Vice Chancellor, we need to do something like this, you know, unprecedented. And almost immediately, there was a tick to that, and we're having this set. So I can allude to that fact. But again, like rightly said, you said you'll be leaving this year. This is the fourth convocation ceremony. But there is a whole lot of lineup of activities. And for anybody who cares to worry, they look at the matriculation, they look at the convocation, they look at the 6 years anniversary of the university. They also look at the NUCA games. All of this is packed in a whole year. And again, there is the POP, personal parade at some point will come in. I mean, I am beginning to think, what's the magic? How exactly are you going to be able to, you know, shape this, this tide? Because for me, it's a whole lot packed in a whole year.
Well, I just described the corporate cooperation that we're having, management council, and divinely, again, we have these major events coming up this year.
Yes.
Just in time for the VC to put in his best yet again. So God wanted him to do all the major events before leaving. So I'm still trying to see how, I'm a senator, I'm still trying to see how I can change the constitution and make him stay longer than that.
Well, if you consider the fact that, I mean, for a particular year, I mean, there was wranglings and all around, and then, of course, the whole lot of time was actually, you know, wasted more like, and then, anyway, let's come down to what also...
Yeah, I think I should answer that.
Yes.
I'll use the opportunity to invite
yes.
you.
Yes.
On the 25th of January.
Okay.
We are launching, I'm hosting the launch of a book.
Interesting.
Called the... Audacity of Professor Budibe's Resilience.
The so, audacity.
So if you want to know more about how we have been making it, try to get the book after the 25th of January.
interesting stuff. Mm-hmm. Sir, before we let you go, I will be graduating about 12,217 students. The last time we actually achieved a round figure in FIT, in CGPA FIT, was 5.00, I think some 5 years ago. We've not been able to go that FIT any longer. But we're closest to achieving that under his administration. 4.98 we saw last year. I almost thought that maybe this year we hit the 5.0 mark. And this year we have 4.95. Interestingly, from a faculty where he belongs, Faculty of Science. And it interests me particularly, and I'm sure a lot of audience wants to be aware. In the last couple of years, the best graduate student under 4 years under his administration has been from the area of sciences and not much of the humanities. I want to say that it says a lot about his powers and of course his interest in building research in the area of science. But apart from that, sir, there's one thing that comes to mind. Apart from building research and all of, in the area of sciences, what are the things, you know, under your watch that you think we can do to ensure that this whole idea of having to bring out the best of students is sustained? Because interest is very massive. Because science is not something that you just sit down and you get results all over in one day. For me, I have to put that to, you know, a very powerful vision. I'm having a fear in me that once he leaves office, can this be sustained? It's a fear in me from the academic angle.
Well, you must know that Rome was not built by one person. So Professor Ogundipe has a lot of support. They are not all leaving this year. Mm. And of course, we have also developed the very strong interest in making sure we improve yearly. So we have many things we're going to introduce. We keep on talking about different things that are practical. Mm. For example, that are relevant to the country today, like agriculture, for example. We need to develop interest of the students in that direction. We need to also introduce things like professional policing to make our students interested in becoming a constable in the police force. Mm. To improve our police and security is a major problem. So practical education for the country is the focus I want to have, and I'm discussing it with the Vice Chancellor, and to make sure that we are really relevant in changing the society to make it a better place for everybody.
Interesting stuff. Without doubt, the Vice Chancellor in the past couple of years since became the Vice Chancellor has been able to do things that are quite remarkable from the area of entrepreneurship, innovation, sports. I've also been very privileged to actually be with the sports team contingent at different stages during his administration, and it's been overwhelming. And we can't but, you know, thank the Vice Chancellor for everything he's done. Even the staff, just a couple of moments ago, I was talking about, you know, the involvement of the non-teaching staff in research administration, which is something very noble, and we can only hope that we'll see, you know, that, you know, manifest in its full-blown capacity. And all of that would be to the glory of God Almighty. We want to say a big thank you for having you on the set today. Any final words, sir, please?
Well, I just want to ask you, well, I hope you are not doing this as a valedictory interview.
It is not a valedictory interview.
Because we are still considering this attempt to leave us.
You know, it's something that has raised concern among some of his faithfuls, and that's why there's a need for us to have answers to them. And interestingly, you'll be able to give good answers to this.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, sir.
So, unity of purpose, that's my pattern.
Honesty of purpose, too.
Honesty of purpose, yes.
Thank you so much, sir, for your time. Okay, that's the Pro-Chancellor of the University of Lagos, the University of First Choice and the Nation's Pride. That's what we pride ourselves. Interestingly, he's an alumnus, so he understands the toga very much. And you can see the confidence of what we produce as alumnus. You know, it's so remarkable. Today, we witnessed a whole lot of them in the auditorium. Justice Amina Adamu Aoge is an alumna. The Right Honorable Speaker of the House of Representatives is an alumnus as well, too. And he right seated next to me is also a great alumnus of the university. We must say a big thank you to you for coming on the show, sir. Thank you so very much. We'll be taking a very short breather, and when we come back, it will still be more guests and a whole lot of things to talk about. We'll be right back.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for still staying tuned. And of course, we are still very much in the all of having the big weight, the heavyweight people. I know we said to you during the course of our show earlier this morning when we opened up by telling you that we have a whole lot of events lined up for your viewing pleasure. Wherever you are the part of the world, we are beaming live here at the JF Ade Ajayi Auditorium of the University of Lagos, the first and of course one of the best and of course the most prestigious institution you have in this whole wide of the universe, the University of Lagos. It's also very interesting to note that the University of Lagos is by the Lagoon front, and some are more like a remark, you know, about the Pro Chancellor being a fundie of having to, you know, spend time at the Lagoon front. I'm also going to be asking my next guest how exactly he takes his time out, because he also shares almost some similarity. He lives by the, you know, by the Lagoon front, because that's the signature. That's supposed to be the biggest thing that you can identify the University of Lagos with, because we are just by the Lagoon front. It gives me one pleasure to welcome here on the set of the University of Lagos 2020 Convocation Studio our number one citizen within these confines, Professor Oluwa Antonio Gudupe, FAS, is a fellow of the Academy of Science, and of course the paleontologist, yes, is a consultant paleontologist, and of course the head of the Lagos State Research Innovation Council, last week, that is. My pleasure to welcome Professor Oluwa Antonio Gudupe. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, it's a remarkable event. I mean, just like we've always been seeing over the past couple of years, what you've been able to achieve and all that, how exactly? Because something, you know, just came in now, and it was more like, surprised to hear that there's going to be launch of a book. To me, I've not heard it. And the title is quite huge. The audacity of Professor Oluwa Antonio Gudupe. And that brings me to the question, have you been able to weather that storm? I know everything comes down to God, but it has your own strength as a man. You've been able to come back strong and do things that are remarkable. I can begin to reel out a whole lot of things that seems to have happened from the embryo loop till this very moment. Have been able to achieve all of that?
Well, first, like you rightly said, I want to return all the glory to the Almighty God. It's not by might, it's not by power, just by the Spirit of the Living God. Two, this that you see happening, all they are based on vision. The vision that God gave me. And you know, when God gives you a vision or visions, He will make sure that He implement it. So what you are seeing is the implementation of the vision that God gave me when I came into the office. Like some people asking me, do you rest at all? I rest a lot, and I sleep at the right time, and I rest at the right time. So it's just the implementation or manifestation of the power of God, making everything to work out well at the right time. So that's why I say I give God all the glory. Then the other side of it is about the cooperation that I've been able to get from my colleagues, from staff, academic staff, non-academic staff, from the union. Because my own belief in life is that when there is peace, you'll be able to do a lot of work.
Absolutely.
Where there is rancoring, there is a disagreement, what you'll be doing is to settle the differences. Mm-hmm. So you can see that in the University of Lagos, we have peace. And because we have peace, that's why we have progress. Because we have progress, you see manifestation of the power of God and everything falling into place.
Absolutely. So I know that we cannot overemphasize the things you highlighted. You know, the acronym University of Lagos has a deep meaning under your administration. You read that out, you know, some couple of moments ago, and then we've been able to see how you've been able to actualize all of that, because you actually made instances to why each letter meant good meaning to you. But beyond that, there's one thing that a lot of people seems to see at the very least, you know, of our worries. But yeah, it's something supposed to be unifying, and it's gratifying to see that you are trying to make them understand that one of the best forms of unification is through sports. We'll be hosting the Nuga Games, and I've also been privileged to also hear you say that we'll not just rest on that. We are going to take it a bit global by also doing the West African University Game. But let's start off with the Nuga Games. The Nuga Games started, committees are working, the pitches are almost looking very set, tillage is going on. But beyond that, a lot of alumni, they're coming together, and corporate bodies, it seems something is huge. But beyond just unification, sir, it's supposed to be a springboard for discovery of talent. Can you tell us exactly what is around the Nuga Games?
Well, the first thing about the Nuga Games is to showcase the beauty of the University of Lagos. The second thing about the Nunga Games is to let the world know that Unilag is a brand. The third thing about Nunga Games is to showcase our students, to let the world know that from this part of the world, you have the best in every aspect of sporting activities. And the fourth thing about Nunga Games is to now bring into focus what Nunga Games used to be in the past, where you develop new athletes who will be able to compete globally, and some of the footballers who will be able to join clubs outside and will be proud of. And the fifth thing about Nunga Games is to let people know that from this part of the world, it is not about the negative report they are writing about Nigeria, but we have a lot of good things that can come out of this land, that can come out of Nigeria. And for some of us that are very proud of this country, somebody like me, I am very proud of this country. I remember in 2001 when I was in the US, and my old professor told me that they are going to employ me in the university there. I told him, I'm going back to Nigeria. I'm committed to my country. I believe in my country. But I even told him jokingly, I said, Dan, for you to believe I'm going back to Nigeria, maybe you'll be the one that will take me to the airport and be sure that I boarded the plane that is coming to Nigeria. I never lose anything since I came back from the US concerning that. So I want us to know that this Nunga game is a unique one. The last thing about this Nunga game is not a local one that we localized to Abaca. That was why we call it a city game. That means that we are going to use other places in Lagos. Because here you are expecting over 10,000 people coming to Akoka. It means that for the city to enjoy that interaction in terms of commerce, in terms of interaction, cultural exchange, we need to let Lagos know that it is not about Akoka, it's about Lagos State. And definitely, it's going to be the best Nunga Games that we have ever had in this country.
Let's quickly inform that the conversation is live on YouTube, on Instagram, on Facebook, and of course on Twitter. You can just go all across all of the social media platforms by actually going through the hashtag Unilag Convocation Studios. And if you so wish, you can also use our big, you know, hashtag talking about Unilag, University of Lagos 2020 Convocation hashtag. Now, the final word, sir, entrepreneurship. Key thing. I know you're a father of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship has actually thrived well under your administration. I am a living witness to that. And it is quite interesting and satisfying that we're having our first set of graduates. You said this thing, that you want people to have dual certificate.
Yeah.
Sir, you are living the dream and you are going to be having a first set at this year's convocation. I'm sure you're quite elated. Sir, it's beginning and I know that you must have one of few words to encourage people so that people can know that this is real. This can also be sustained.
Well, I want to say that with spirit of humility, University of Lagos will be the first university to be talking about that space of student having a diploma degree in entrepreneurship, and it can be diploma gold, diploma silver, depending on what they are able to get out of that experience before they graduate from the university. But this is the first one, so it's just a diploma for those people that register for the program and they are able to go through all the stages. And so this time around we are going to graduate about 200 out of those students. But my belief,
yes,
is that when you talk about entrepreneurship for our students, we are seeing that we should expose them to the business world. We don't want our students to be one that will go get out of the university, then they'll start looking for jobs. We want our students to be employer of labor. We want our students to showcase themselves that they are from a university that is a cosmopolitan university. There's no university in this country that you can say that's a cosmopolitan university. It's only University of Lagos that you call it a cosmopolitan university. A university that is within the business community. The economy of this country is being managed or controlled from Lagos State.
Yes.
So we want our students to be able to start their own business. The university will register the business for them free. And also the only thing the university will put when they are registering is there's going to be 5% of the share will be for the university. That's what they have even in MIT and other universities outside the country. Also, the university will have a mentor for them, the mentor that will mentor them so that they will be able to do well when they are handling the business. Look at one of them now that is going to even give gifts to the best graduating student from what she is able to produce. So you can see that the effort is yielding fruit. So my joy is that in my own time as representative of God as the Vice Chancellor, I'm seeing this happening. And I know that more will happen in the next 1-2 years and subsequent years to come. So I'm happy about that. Even in the area of innovation, there are a lot of talent, there are a lot of potentials that our students are carrying about. The best thing for us is to be able to harvest that potential, to be able to bring it out of them and showcase it to the world. Look at our students going for competition outside the country before COVID pandemic. They are doing well. And I'm sure even after this pandemic thing, this very year, some of them will now start going out of the university for competition. The American University Bank, three or four of our students went there to do their IT. 3 years ago, some of our students that went there to do IT, by that they finished, they were employed. Right from the time they are about to finish their program, we want our own students to be able to be relevant locally and to be able to compete globally. That's what we want. And I'm sure, as my Lord liveth, by the time I look back, I will say, God, you have been good to us.
Absolutely, without doubt. So, final words before you go. I mentioned to the Pro-Chancellor, sometimes how you almost act as instance. They tell you things, I look at the creativity behind it, you look at where this is supposed to lead, and you pick it all up. I was also informed last week about the setting up of a convocation studio. And the manager was telling me, I'll speak to the vice, go speak with the vice chancellor. And on Saturday or Friday, he was telling me, Bayo is approved of it. And it was to my utmost surprise, truth be told, it was to my utmost surprise. But I want to tell you, sir, this whole idea was just birthed from the wake of the COVID pandemic. And of course, like it was rightly mentioned, we're one of, in fact, the first university to actually get online to acclimatize our students to the new normal. And that's why we're also doing this. Aside from people understanding that we're doing a convocation ceremony, there's also a need for them to also be taken around and also feel the pulse of the many people who will be gracing the occasion. And this we are doing. Sir, what's your take on this we have done?
Let me say that I'm really impressed. You have not just a pass mark. You have an excellent mark.
Thank you so very much.
And I did that because I know that I have a pro-chancellor that when I discuss it with, he will not start querying it. He will be excited when you are talking about innovation, about moving the university forward. The interaction between myself and the pro-chancellor is just like brothers. At times, when I tell people that we disagree, and when we disagree, we agree again. I will now move because we are interested in moving the university forward. And seeing something like this is about moving the university forward. It's about showcasing the skill of our people to the world that we can do what they are doing in CNN. And I am praying that very soon, Unilag TV, by the time we move to DSTV platform, we'll be able to showcase to the world that definitely we have talent. We have people. I believe in people. When I work with people and I cite you up, I know that you are good. I give you all the necessary support that you need. But if I see you to be a lazy person, I will not even allow you to come to my office anyway. But I can see in him somebody that is with his team, somebody that is innovative, somebody that is ready to move the place forward, somebody that is ready to showcase the Unilag television as one of the best in the world. So why shouldn't I support him? So I give him kudos with his team. Like I said, it is not just pass mark. They have excellent mark for this.
Wow, I must say, this is coming from the office board himself. He's saying that he's given an excellent pass mark for what we've actually done, and we can only hope that we sustain this particular innovation. It's almost time that we'll say bye-bye now to our Vice Chancellor. I know that there's so much that he's actually going to do today, and it's a week-long event, and without doubt, we appreciate you for coming and, of course, gracing the set. I mean, it's the first of his kind, it's unprecedented. Of course, we're a man of many firsts. And that also takes me back to the line of the Pro-Chancellor saying that he's a man full of honesty. So he's got honest of purpose, and I've seen that without doubt. Thank you so very much, Mr. Vice Chancellor. All right, guys, the Vice Chancellor has been on set with me talking about a whole lot of things that seems to have actually changed the narrative since he assumed office and what they will still have in plan, you know, in the coming months ahead. And you all agree with me that the University of Lagos remains an indelible elysium of thought for a lot of people who are possible, who are stakeholders, and of course, average Nigerians, students alike, and of course, professors, academics, because we are cosmopolitan, and of course, we are the university that is pride as the best, the first, and the only in the country called Nigeria. I want to say a big thank you to everybody who's actually been behind and making this work. And of course, we'll be doing our very short breather. And when we come back, we still have more guests to, of course, grace our set as we still count down to the week-long activities of our convocation ceremony. We'll be right back. You are welcome back, and you're still the University of Lagos Convocation Studios, beaming live here at the JF Ade Ajayi Auditorium of our prestigious university. My name is Bayo Salau, and of course, we have a very big guest as well joining just after the Vice Chancellor has taken his leave. Sometimes it's somewhat indescribable how exactly you want to introduce him when you have him inside, but again, I will only describe him as a man who has got so many firsts. He's a man, even through my learning experience as a young journalist, I was able to read through many of his works, and of course, without doubt, I have got so much big, huge admirations for him. Permit me to welcome, as he is fondly called within this conference and beyond, the doyen of mass communication, Professor Raf Akinfeleye. You're welcome on set, please.
Thank you very much.
Prof, it's quite a delight to see you. I mean, you're looking almost young as ever. I mean, it's interesting to see. Okay, beyond that, I'm sure this is your dream, and you are living your dream.
How have you been able to achieve this?
Well, first of all, I want to say that we give honor and glory to the Almighty God. And also to let you know that I've spent over 3 decades in the University of Lagos, serving about 9 vice chancellors, and also serving as the chairman of Senate convocation ceremony for a cumulative period of 15 years. So I know the history, the geography, the philosophy, the notes and the buts of convocation. So we thank God that we're able to start the one for this year. And I'm a professor of journalism and mass communication. And council member of the World Journalism Education Congress, representing Africa for the next 3 years. So I'm at home, and I want to thank God for making this convocation a reality. Some years ago, a convocation was canceled by somebody. A journey that started with smooth takeoff started experiencing serious turbulence. But we thank God that God has quenched the fire on the mountain. I was an eyewitness in the transition of the vice chancellorship of Professor Rahman Bello and Professor Ogudipe. This was very smooth. And I pray that it will be a smooth takeoff, turbulence-free flight, and a safe landing.
Amen.
The journey had a smooth takeoff, but the past few 2 years ago, it experienced a lot of turbulence, instability. But thank God, God intervened with a new dispensation, with a new chairman of council, who, in my judgment, is compatible with the current vice chancellor. And the vice chancellor, in my judgment, happened to be a very humble person. I would describe him not only a go-getter, but based on his performance within these 4 years, he has metamorphosed from being a goal-getter to a goal-scorer. He scored so many goals. You had a few minutes ago at the convocation lecture, this university, the University of Lagos, the nation's pride, got a total of 17 billion grant. So I've been to the university for more than 3 decades, more than 35 years. I've never seen any administration talking about 17 billion grants. During our time, when we started this thing, we got some grant to start a radio for television from the World Bank. But it was not up to 17 billion. So, on comparative basis, we want to say and encourage Professor Oluwatoyin Ogundipe for an excellent performance. 17 billion grand, 17 billion naira is not a joke.
Prof, you seem to be actually impressed with that particular feat.
Yes.
Without doubt, it's a very huge one.
Yeah.
But beyond that, I was going to be more specific.
Okay.
Which is you now, your involvement in the success being recorded under his administration, why we've been able to actually, got to this level of achievement. And when I say this level, I'm looking at the instance at which we got the radio working, we got the TV working. At some point, it seems like there was a blip. We're still very much in that, at the tooting stage, without doubt. But I'll be very much interested that I'm not still very comfortable where we are, even though I think it's a big achievement. But what are the things you would have as plans to see us rival the biggest of the biggest media houses? It's achievable. If you talk about Channel Television today, the so-called owner of Channel Television passed through you. You know, if you talk about Mumin Alao today, it passed through you. The registrar of the university passed through you and a host of other notable names. And I'm beginning to imagine that if you're able to bring people who've got reputations to put, you know, media outfits, you know, be it PR, be it mainstream, you know, broadcast and print media, into the right perspective, what are your plans? Quite bargaining, I would be interested to know what you want to do for University of Lagos TV and University of Lagos FM, frequency mode.
Well, thank you very much. I agree with you. The history of Radio Unilag and Unilag Television is very complex. Mm-hmm. It's not easy. I'm a graduate of the World Journalism School at the University of Missouri, Columbia. And I got here, but I issue now degrees and specialize in broadcasting without a radio, without a television station. So it occurred on me to tell the vice chancellor and also the chairman of the department that's a need for us to practicalize this. So we started to have application for Radio Unilag. All the successful attempts by us were touted by the military administration. Because they didn't think that a university should have a radio station. They thought they would be using for Luta. So they would not allow us to have a radio station. So 2002, Dan Ladi Bako became the Director General of NBC. And I told him that we have an application pending. He said, don't worry, we'll try his best. And suddenly one afternoon he just called me that we just got our approval that OBJ assigned our letter of approval for the radio license. We were very happy. So the Vice Chancellor then asked me, what do we do, Professor Raff? I said, what we need to do is to get a World Press Conference thanking the federal government for giving us the first campus radio station license, and also telling them that they are giving us seed equipment to start the program. Then we started the program. Before that time, we were doing what they call narrow casting.
You want to tell more about what that is?
Yes. Originally, in the University of Lagos and the Department of Mass Comm, when I joined them, I think they were doing what I've termed nothing casting. From nothing casting, they metamorphosed into narrow casting. From narrow casting, now we have digital broadcasting. So it's a pride for me to be able to be involved in the creation and establishment of Radio Unilag and television. The television story is also more complex because they have never given license to any campus. And when we were doing this one, breaking news, that the president had just signed our license. I said, what are you saying? He said, the radio, Unilag TV has just been signed by the president, Buhari.
Wow.
What? So I took my step. I went to the vice chancellor. They was in the meeting of professors. I told him about breaking news. This is what happened. They clapped for me. And then we now started the television. And before that time, the same cow sent a letter to me, Stinker, that Radio Unilag was violating their reach. And therefore, we cannot be applying for television. So I said, well, you have to separate Genesis from Exodus.
So they are two separate entities.
Yes, so at the end of the day, the license was given to us, and we are not getting a license for fun. It was a DSB, Direct Satellite Broadcast Television. It on the first round is a commercial television station. We had to pay $10 million for the license through the company of the VC, the current VC, and water. We went to Abuja to pay the $10 million fee for the license. We were planning to go straight onto DSTV or GoTV, but apparently many things happened. They then hook us to Star Times. It was a misadventure, to say the least. For leaving us and giving us with
I'll be quite delighted to see we make that that misdrive and back to
that's what we are trying to do now. And I now told the VC that they are deviating from our original plan. Our original plan was to get